So where is the Earth's water? Check out this diagram. Over 97% of the Earth's water is in the oceans. It's salty, not particularly useful for most human uses. What's the second largest pool of water in the Earth system? Glacial ice. This is ice that exists on land. So most of the glacial ice in the world is either in Antarctica or in Greenland, although a few high mountain peaks may have glacial ice as well. So this water is frozen and far away, also not particularly useful to us here in California. So that's over 99% of the Earth's water, either salty or frozen. The next largest pool of the Earth's water, though, is groundwater. We're going to spend a few moments here now talking about groundwater. So this is the largest fresh, not frozen, liquid, not ice, source of water that we have here on Earth. And if you add up those top three pools of water, that's over 99.9% of the Earth's water. So let's take a look at groundwater. Groundwater is not simply all the water that exists underground. It's only some of the water that exists underground. It's the water that exists in saturated pores or fractures. Thus, water that exists in the unsaturated zone here is not groundwater. We'll just call it soil water. You'll know if you dug a hole where the groundwater begins, because water will start to empty out of the pore spaces and flow down into your hole or well. You've probably all done this at some point when you were a child at the beach. You dug until you hit groundwater. Water started to fill your hole. On the diagram, you can see there's the unsaturated zone, the zone of aeration, and then the saturated zone. This is groundwater. The top of the saturated zone is called the water table. Notably, the water table moves up and down depending on how much surface water is infiltrating and how much groundwater humans are pumping out. Study this diagram until you feel comfortable with the terms groundwater, unsaturated zone, saturated zone, and water table. Can you explain it to someone else? Can you draw a similar diagram on your own? So we know that groundwater is the water that exists in the ground in the saturated pores of soil and the saturated fractures of rock. But where on Earth should we dig to look for it? The quick answer is that groundwater exists virtually everywhere if you dig deep enough. Some places the water table is closer to the surface, and hydrologists read the topography of the landscape as well as the location of trees and plants to figure out where a good place to drill might be. Locally, if you happen to live down on the flat areas of Redwood City, San Carlos, Belmont, Menlo Park, or Palo Alto, you probably could simply drill 10 to 15 feet down and hit groundwater. If you live at higher elevations, you'd likely have to dig much deeper. Next, we're going to look at how groundwater moves. Look at the diagram and note that the water table has a slight slope to it. Groundwater simply flows from higher elevation to lower elevation, downhill, just like surface water. We joke that the only thing you need to know to be a hydrologist, which I am, is that water flows downhill. Another important point that we can glean from this diagram is that surface water and groundwater are really the same water in some ways. Surface water infiltrates down into groundwater, and sometimes groundwater can feed local streams. They interact often. It's really the same water. So here in California, where we have different rules and different laws for surface water and groundwater, it's kind of strange. Okay, so we know that water flows down gradient. But how does a hydrologist figure out what downhill means in terms of the water table? Well, generally you dig monitoring wells, as the top diagram here represents. And then once you know the elevation of the actual water in those wells, that's the elevation of the water table. You can plot that on a map and draw some contour lines and come up with a pretty good representation of the elevation of the water table. Water then simply goes down that gradient. It crosses those contour lines perpendicularly and moves downward. One primary difference between groundwater flow and surface water flow, however, is that groundwater is much slower. On average, it moves around 3 to 4 inches per day, but in some cases it might move much, much slower than that, if it was traveling through clay, for instance. For comparison, some large rivers may move 5 to 10 feet per second, which is about 80 to 160 miles per day. So groundwater moving 3 to 4 inches per day is quite slow. The speed of groundwater depends on two factors: the slope of the water table, also called the hydraulic gradient, and the permeability of the material it's trying to flow through. That's sometimes called the hydraulic conductivity. So the slope of the water table is called the hydraulic gradient, and the steeper the hydraulic gradient, the faster the flow. The diagram here demonstrates that the slope is simply rise over run, just like in your math class. And you can measure it by determining the elevation of the water table in two adjacent wells and then measuring the distance between them. Permeability refers to the ability of a substance to transmit fluid. Some subsurface materials, like sands and gravels, transmit water easily. Other substances, for example clay, have a low permeability. Imagine we have two tubes, one filled with gravel and one filled with clay. Both are open at the ends and oriented in upright position. And there are mesh screens on the tubes to hold in the gravel and clay. If we poured water on top of the gravel-filled tube, it would flow through the tube very quickly and spill onto the floor. If we poured water on top of the clay, it would eventually soak into the clay, but it might take days, weeks, or years to flow downward through the tube. This chart here shows permeability in the column that's called specific yield. So clay has a very low permeability because it doesn't yield as much water. Less water would flow through that tube. Notably, hydraulic gradient can be easily calculated, but usually we have to estimate permeability values because the subsurface is generally not uniform over large distances. So how can you tell if you are at risk of groundwater contamination? Well, basically hydrologists will determine if your well is upgradient or downgradient from a pollution source. If the well is upgradient, it's safe from contamination. If it's downgradient, it's at risk. Next, hydrologists will look at the permeability of the subsurface. If the subsurface material is made out of gravels or sands, the pollution will move quickly. If the subsurface material is clay, the pollution might take years, decades, or even centuries to move a mile or so. This sounds pretty straightforward, but the difficulties lie in the variable nature of the subsurface, and importantly, in knowing where the contamination source is. There are many old sources that are unknown to present residents. Most old gas stations prior to the 1990s likely had leaky underground storage tanks. Perhaps one of these stations closed down decades ago and the tanks were removed, then a housing development went up. The residues from the old leaks are likely still present in the soil. For a shocking example, similar to this, look into the Love Canal neighborhood of New York, where a neighborhood and two elementary schools were built on top of a dump site for toxic chemicals. Looking at this diagram here, if you live in the purple house and there's a known pollution source next door at location Y, are you at risk of contaminating your well? Perhaps not. You're upgradient. However, what if there was an old gas station that was leaking at location X, and since that time they actually paved over it and put a mall in, and you don't even know that it existed? Is your well at risk? Likely. Next, let's look at the different types of aquifers. First, a definition. Aquifers are the underground layers of water-bearing material from which groundwater can be economically extracted. So not all groundwater would be considered a viable aquifer. Also note that there's two types of aquifers. as shown in this diagram: unconfined aquifers and confined aquifers. Let's check each of these out in a little bit more detail. In an unconfined aquifer, the water table marks the top of the aquifer, and the bottom of the aquifer generally has some sort of impermeable material called an aquitard. Notice the water table, and remember that the water table can move up and down seasonally, and it may also move down if there's a lot of pumping. Also note that in order for a well to be able to pump water, the well must be below the water table. When a well is pumping, it reduces the water table level directly around the well. This is called the cone of depression. When the pumping stops, the cone of depression will eventually rebound back to the water table. Notice this well over here is not pumping. I know that because there's no cone of depression. Next, check out what happens when one well starts pumping great quantities of water. The other local wells may go dry, and they might not even know why they've gone dry. They likely don't know who else has wells, where the wells are located, or how much they're even pumping. When the high volume well stops pumping, the other wells may have water again. Confined aquifers, as their name suggests, are aquifers that are trapped between two impermeable layers, between two aquitards. These aquifers do not have a water table. Also, the water in the aquifer is under pressure. In some cases, when you drill into this type of aquifer, the water may actually flow up to the ground surface without pumping. This type of aquifer is a great find because you can save a lot of money not having to pump water. Why is it they're under pressure? Check out this diagram for an explanation. In California, about 30% of our commercial water deliveries are groundwater, but actual groundwater use is much higher, as that number only considers purchased water. It doesn't take into account farms and individuals who have their own wells. Indeed, California State Water Resources Board estimates that about 85% of Californians depend on groundwater for all or part of their water supply. Groundwater is important. Notably, though, there's several issues we need to discuss associated with withdrawing groundwater. First, groundwater is being used as a non-renewable resource in many parts of the country. That means it's being withdrawn faster than it recharges. This map shows the important aquifers in the United States, including the very important Ogallala Aquifer here in the central part of the country. This is our largest aquifer, and in much of the southern part of this aquifer, it's being used dramatically faster than it's being naturally recharged. That means eventually this is not sustainable and we'll run out of that water. Recent data from NASA shows that there's several different regions of the United States where we're using groundwater at a much faster rate than it's being naturally recharged. A second very important issue is saltwater intrusion. If we pump too much groundwater, we can start to bring in saltwater from below, or if you live in coastal areas, from adjacent regions. This is why we don't use a whole lot of groundwater here on the peninsula. We'd be sucking in saltwater. Another very important issue, particularly here in California, is subsidence. This is when we pump groundwater out faster than it can be recharged, the overlying weight of the material above the aquifer ends up pushing down and smashing down the now empty soil pores and making the ground sink. Check out this diagram showing where the land surface was in the Central Valley in 1925, 1955, and 1977, and you can imagine that it's even lower today. We were able to stop subsidence for decades when we started relying more on surface water for Central Valley agriculture. But during the recent drought, farmers turned to groundwater, and we've had massive subsidence in the southern Central Valley, which is going to cost us all taxpayers money as we try to repair roads and aqueducts and other structures that were affected by this ground subsidence. Lastly, groundwater pumping can sometimes lead to new pollution problems. Check out what happens when the neighbors come in and start pumping a high-volume well. Your own septic tank may contaminate your water as the gradient now has changed.